Welcome to everybody. I am thrilled to introduce our keynote speaker today, Helga Garcia Garza. The first time I met Helga, I was at a meeting with La Red in El Rio Abajo. It's a network of social service providers from the South Valley of Albuquerque. And just being in her presence, as you'll soon hear, Helga's power is palpable and her vision is so inspiring. She's a community wisdom keeper, a mentor, and a steadfast force for good in both New Mexico and through the entire planet. Helga deeply understands the connections between environmental, health, economic, and food justice, as exemplified in her work as the executive director of the Agricultura Network, otherwise known as ACN, a farmer-owned cooperative in Albuquerque's South Valley. The network includes 32 allied farms from urban and rural Rio Grande communities, committed to sustainable and regenerative growing methods. Helga is inspired by justice and guided by her ancestral ceremonial agricultural calendar, engaging communities through a holistic intergenerational approach and developing a sustainable food system and environmental economy for New Mexico. By developing community-driven markets that strengthen and build assets of local farmers while preserving New Mexico's historic culture and tradition in a sustainable agriculture, Helga is leading efforts that have increased equitable access to healthy local food by removing structural barriers such as procurement policy, price, availability, and increasing nutritional knowledge through curriculum development of a holistic family-based wellness program that is bilingual, culturally relevant, and community-based. Through these efforts, Helga is building the capacity of New Mexico's urban and rural small farmers' ability to keep production local through an effective farm-to-market system. Agricultura Network ensures a household livelihood by providing farmers the opportunity to grow food for their community, contributing to positive health outcomes, economic activity, and well-being. Helga is a Robert Wood Johnson Foundation Culture of Health Leader from 2018 to 2021, a Castanea Fellow from 2020 to 2022, and serves on the governing board chair as the governing board chair of the New Mexico Food and Agricultural Policy Council, and is the president of the South Valley Main Street. Please join me in welcoming Helga Garcia Garza.
Thank you, Jules. I am honored beyond words to have been asked to share our story and our experience building our cooperative here in Tiwa territory, also known as Albuquerque. For us, the journey started in 2008, where we had identified almost our last generation of traditional farmers. Families could no longer make a livelihood, especially working on small scale farming. And when I say small scale, I'm talking a quarter of an acre of hoop house to the largest, maybe 3 acres. So in 2008, we were brought together by one of our mentors, Mr. Don Bustos, who is a farming mentor for so many of us and owns the Santa Cruz farm in northern New Mexico. He trained about six farmers, new farmers, those that still had the desire to learn and hopefully be able to make a living. So the six farmers came from the South Valley of Albuquerque. He trained them for 1 year. And that from that is how Agricultura Network was formed. In 2009, after the year of training with Mr. Don Bustos, all he could say next is, gotta go figure it out. What are you gonna do? How are you gonna obtain land, those that did not have land? So then in 2009, we started promoting of a theory of change. How are we gonna do this collectively? We knew that we wanted to keep our production local. We wanted to continue ancestral farming knowledge, which is now called sustainable and regenerative. And we also just wanted to feed our community. We still had that desire of how do we take care of the earth, but how do we take care of each other? So with that concept, we started having the weekly meetings and all that. At the same time, we started entering into policy work because we knew that we had to have a viable market in order to really anchor our theory of change. In 2010, that's when the first legislative funding for farm to school was provided. And it was a small funding budget of about $150,000 for the whole state of New Mexico. So, but at the same time, that was early staging. We still didn't have our concept. It was still a theory for us. So when that funding came in, Public Education Department and Albuquerque Public Schools was taking a lead within the state. So that funding is what really put our theory of change into practice. Can we really do this? Can we really work together? Can we really come together as small-scale farmers to meet that larger market? First thing we had to do is we had to find the facility in order for us to be able to put this theory into practice. If you bear with me for 1 second, I'm gonna. Okay, how do I move? Okay.
Looks good.
All right. Sorry about that. I want to thank Jessica Swan for being my tech person here. I do a lot of things, but I have very little technology patience. So there had been this, there's this facility here in the South Valley as an active South Valley resident. I was one of the ones that was in the community meetings, in the community focus meetings, when this facility was being brought into our neighborhood. All of those community meetings that have to take place before an actual food hub. And this is a food incubation, food development in here in the South Valley and in Albuquerque. So the South Valley Economic Development Center, we came knocking at the door because we needed the infrastructure that could meet all of our permitting necessary to market raw produce. So the first year here at the South Valley Economic Development Center, we started at a very small scale because we were only 5 cooperative farms. And cooperative farms, but those farmers did own their land and they did own their farms. The South Valley of Albuquerque has a long, long history and continues to this day to be an agricultural zone. And we are not really, even though our address is Albuquerque, we're really in Bernalillo County. So for us, I mean, we don't really vote. We can't vote for the mayor. We, you know, there's a lot of pieces and we've been left on our own with very small economic development. We were left in the zone of brownfield sites, of Superfund sites, all of that. So the South Valley, we've been what is when the word resilient, and we have maintained our way of life without any real investment. We don't even have bus service on Sundays to this day. So for us, it was really important for this facility to come to life and to really serve the people of Albuquerque and the people of the South Valley in food development. So This facility has been that for us all these years. Okay, I can't move it. Okay. So here is our theory of change. And what we wanted to do is, how do we bring the farmers together that they can make a living off of their production, keep building capacity of their farms, and how do we really stay true to our mission? So for us, it was a stable South Valley means that farmers in the South Valley can support the livelihood of their owners and workers while contributing to the community and environmental sustainability of the community. So this is where we started to make that change. PED came in with the funding, but at the same time, it was new to everyone, and we had to start changing mindsets because they were used to decades and decades of the global food system, where you get whatever you want any time of the year, and it was at the cheapest, the fastest, and the easiest. So when we came in, they were used to paying, you know, 28 cents for a pound of carrots, and they were not willing to pay, you know, $2.75, $3 a pound for organic carrots. So it was really starting to educate. We met with the nutrition directors and went over all of their menus. So that they could understand our seasonal varieties and how we could start changing the menus to meet that. We said, well, we can't give you mangoes, but we can give you apples, peaches, apricots, you know, cherries, raspberries. We can't give you that specific pea, but we can give you okra, we can give you green beans, we can give you. So that's how we started with PED in those early years. And I say this because that became the model, which I will speak about as we keep growing and scaling in local investment. So to this day, our cooperative also has a nonprofit arm, which is La Cosecha. It's our community-supported agricultural program with the mission of equitable food access, nutrition education, and the development of community-driven markets. Agricultura Network continues to be the cooperative model, and both entities need each other to really accomplish what we've accomplished to date. And like I said, PED in 2010, that was the first state investment. And to this day, now we have senior nutrition sites statewide that we deliver food produce to, public education now at a statewide level as well. And the newcomers to institution purchasing is the early childhood centers. And we also market to our major hospitals, UNMH Hospital and Presbyterian, not only here in Albuquerque, but in Santa Fe and Rio Rancho, north of Albuquerque. We also, prior to COVID, we were supplying the Presbyterian Mobile Farmers Market with our produce, and we also had a nutritionist on site. COVID hit, we had to shift, and we shifted into RX food as medicine. And we continue to work on that platform, not only with Presbyterian, but with many other community clinics. In order for us to continue to grow, we've also had to do a lot of policy work. And even though policy work is, one thing I do want to roll back here is that we also do have a farmer training program, which is called Grow the Growers. And we partner with Bernalillo County Open Space. So we're entering into our seventh year in this farm training program. And all of our cooperative farms play a part in that farm training program. They become the mentors, providing days and workshops in their own farms to show what a active working farm day-to-day practice is. But at the same time, they also, through years and years of experience, also offer many other entities in workshop on soil health, seed preservation, water retention. We are in the high desert, and water is a very big issue for us. We're also, one of the reasons the South Valley has not, and we've been given a choice 3 times in this past 25 years, and South Valley has always voted not to become part of the city of Albuquerque. Why? We would lose our agricultural water rights. We would lose the ability to have animals. And like I said, we come from a region and a space where agriculture continues to this day to be an everyday part of our lives. So what we really know when they say, oh, you all can become part of the city of Albuquerque, they're after our water. So we're not so easily, you get all these other benefits. And, you know, like the city of Albuquerque, when they offer different types of funding, we can't apply. So, you know, we also understand all of that, but we also know what they're after, and they're after our water. So the cooperative, like I said, we started with 5 cooperative farms here in the South Valley. This season, we are at 51 farms working together collectively, taking that competitive edge off of what you still experience at farmers markets and trying to penetrate retail and all these other markets. When we come together as a network and as a cooperative, then a price is set. Our governing board of ACN is a farmer-led board. You own your farm, your working farm, and we are also right now amending our bylaws in order for that longevity of the cooperative to make the pathway for the network farmers to be able to be cooperative members as well. So the cooperative itself is the one that runs the governing board. They set the prices. They take care of all of the business management. And they also are the ones that provide all of those necessary steps and processes in order to maintain our governance as a farmer-owned cooperative. The network farmers do not have a voting power, but they do have access to everything else, our loan program, shared seed purchasing, all of our workshops, and of course, the network farms are really the ones that hold the quality, quantity, variety that is needed to meet all of these markets that we have today. Right here is in production. And like I said, we are 51 farms strong. So this facility that I showed you at the very beginning, the South Valley Economic Development Center, is where all of this takes place. For us, we do have, it's a shared facility, but us as organic farmers have our own space that only we use, that only we can enter into. That assures that no contamination takes place. We were the first in the state of New Mexico to become GAP certified. Our kitchen is GAP certified. All of our food safety standards, all of our quality control workers, all of the ones that do farm to market are trained within GAP, are trained within the highest levels of food safety. And so this just goes to show you a little bit of when farmers come together collectively under that cooperative model. Farmers make projections weekly. They make them on Wednesdays for the following week. Thursdays, that fresh list goes out to all of our customers and everybody begins to purchase. Friday, the farmer is told when he needs to bring what was bought and when he needs to bring it in, depending on when it's going out. They usually have anywhere from 24 to 48 hours to get it to our facility. Then we have another 24 to 48 hours to get it out to market. So we do that because it gives us that, we say we're giving you the highest quality of nutrient food, and us maintaining that projection list, the farmers only having 24 to 48 hours to get it to us, we do the quality control and it goes out the door. So folks are getting not only organic produce, but at the highest quality, the highest value in nutrition facts. So here we have assembly going on. And as I say, there's so many different markets. Last season, we were moving about 4,500 pounds weekly of New Mexico grown fruits and vegetables. This year, we were moving 7,500 pounds a week. And our last month, our season is from May until the beginning of November, where we are right now. In October, we were moving 10,000 pounds weekly of New Mexico grown fruits and vegetables. And again, when we say that, we also have to understand that two things are going on. All of that money, those purchases, stay within our state. They keep building capacity of the farmers, and it is creating jobs in agriculture. When I say we have 51 farms strong, but those 51 farms employ 200 people. Us in aggregation employ 10 to 12 people. So we are and training and developing skills. Folks aren't just coming in and it's a job. I get paid this hourly wage. Everybody that works for us believes in the mission and wants to support it. So they really want to learn. They want to learn how quality control works. They want to learn value added. They want to learn at all of the GAP process that takes place day to day. GAP is a lot of documentation, as many of you may know. So we are not just hiring people, we are developing skills, aggregation skills, a workforce. This right here, and the reason I bring this photo up is because about 4 years ago, we started to make a transition into farmers that had the capacity and had been working with us and were meeting projections and were producing quality produce. And we started to make a shift. We were rolling into value added. And as our markets grew and we started to review all of the market data, what we needed was farmers to shift from growing a variety of crops to specific crops. And the crops we were looking for were garlic, onion, potatoes, sweet potatoes. We were getting into value added. So these are the farmers that took that step in order to make this shift. And this day we took this picture was the day that we made a commitment to that shift as we were rolling and going to start producing value added. So these are the farmers that said, yes, we want to take part in this new way of growing food specifically for set markets. And the garlic too came from our co-op here, Paula Montanita. They said, we will commit to purchasing hundreds of, I can't remember the poundage of garlic from our organic growers. So this was our first step into a new way of working collectively as a cooperative and a network. And I think that's one way that we look at scaling how we grow. We had to make sure that we were going to have those markets. We knew that value added was coming down the pipeline. We had been already doing our research for a couple of years and getting ourselves set within the facility, within permitting, within all of those steps necessary to put a new product on the line. And the majority of these growers are from the South Valley. There's a couple of them that are from our native pueblos of Jemez and Santo Domingo. This right here shows just some of the collective that goes on within the cooperative. And as I said, our farm training program learns a lot from all of our cooperative farmers. And we set that up in that way so that they can continue to have mentors. Mentors that are set, mentors that are not going anywhere, and mentors that are within reach of any type of support new farmers may need. These are, I'm showing of where, again, cooperative farmers are mentors. As you can see, they are well skilled in their production. And this right here is our farm training program. This was our fifth cohort right here. And where we do the farm training program, the day-to-day is at a state historical site called the Gutierrez Hubble House. And it was the first farm and ranch when you would come in back in the 17th century down the Camino Real, which was the road from Mexico City all the way to Santa Fe. This farm training program has a very important mission behind producing new farmers. The more farmers that go through the program, they go into incubation. We incubate them for another 2 years. They can continue to work and name their farm, but growing on open space land. They continue to have help with seed. They continue to have help with water, workshops, shared tools, and still have the support of a farm training program along with all of the mentors of the co-op. These are the metrics that the county uses when farmland comes up for sale anywhere within Bernalillo County, especially here in the South Valley. The county can advocate for that land by showing how many farmers, new farmers, are producing. We keep all of the data of what is grown, the seed cost, the water allotment, all of the, that type of data. And we also show how much food went back into the community through the farm training program and through the incubation. Incubators, at that point, they've named their farm and they can sell their produce.
Someone provided a reference number when contacting the fraud department. Please provide that information to the next available representative.
You don't recognize.
Thank you for your patience.
This is not my phone. My phone's off. So in the farm training program, though, that because of that cannot be sold. So that is provided back to the community. And it goes back through to the community through our CSA. We also support other mutual aid groups that do a variety of small CSAs for a smaller amount of time. We also donate a lot of food every week to different organizations. So all of this food grown here at this farm training program goes back to the community. And because of the anti-donation clause, we cannot sell it. In the beginning, when we were putting the program together, we thought, well, that's a good way to reinvest what we grow, we sell, and we can put it back into the program. But then the anti-donation clause said we couldn't do that. So this is another way to keep track, but also channel to the groups and the families in need. Our CSA is focused on populations that otherwise would not have, could not afford weekly organic produce or fruits and vegetables. We've made that pathway through SNAP, through the New Mexico Double Up Food Bucks program, and through the many community partners. This is, our CSA is a 320 member strong. It's weekly, and we are also able to do that through many different community partners. Some of them finding their own funding for their membership, which also helps us. And, you know, I've been told several times, oh, well, La Cosecha is a subsidized program. I said, yes, but people paying with SNAP, participating in the Double Up Food Bucks, could do that anywhere else at any other grocery store. They choose to invest in our cooperative model. They choose to invest in their local farmers, and they make a commitment to that for 22 weeks. So yes, it's a subsidized program, but again, they could take that SNAP benefit card and spend it anywhere else and buy produce coming outside of our state and grown with unethical and dangerous practices. When I talked about earlier about the policy work, that has been one of the key factors and drivers in growing our cooperative. Policy was not easy for us to do. Number one, we had to learn the rules of engagement. We were never invited to the table. In fact, we were left out of any conversation. And when I say we, people of color, small scale farmers, traditional farmers in New Mexico. The New Mexico Food and Agricultural Policy Council is a 20-year, has a 20-year, 21-year history, but it's been white-led. It's been in favor of big agriculture and big ranching. And we started to make the changes slowly back in 2009, when we knew we needed that institutional investment in our local growing, in our local growers and ranchers. So in 2020, I was voted chair of the New Mexico Food and Agricultural Policy Council. That took a statewide membership vote, but we had been doing a lot of work, providing data to various committees throughout the year, and really putting the small scale farmers, traditional farmers, at the seat and at the table and navigating our own voice and our own journey. No one spoke for us, we spoke for ourselves. So in that, we started to provide data, you know, like what has been the growth from the first year, how many more farmers entered into the network, how much production, where it was going. And we really started to show the number and the economic activity that the small scale farmer was having. And then we got the eyes on us. So data is very important within our growth. Without that, we couldn't have made all of these changes that we've made within the past 8 years. So the New Mexico Food and Agricultural Policy has played a lead in this shift. And I am the first Native woman of color to ever chair the policy council here in the state of New Mexico. And it hasn't been easy. Policy work is hard enough on its own. And it's even harder when you're making a very drastic change in the way it had been navigated and the powers that be that held that navigation. And I've always am the type, yes, strong voice, all of those pieces. I mean, Jules knows me. And, but at the same time, I'm a person that likes to build strong bridges. I'm the person that's always looking, what is our solution here? And I pick and choose our battles with a lot of thought, with a lot of heart, and with a lot of vision. I know that in the policy council to this day, we have differences, but we always hold on to that common goal. What is our collective commonality here? So that's one of the things that's really been, I think, empowering in the policy council to date now. In this year, I had the policy council, governing board, and the statewide membership go through a racial equity training because they really needed to understand historical bias. And they really needed to understand where small traditional farmers were coming from. You know, we have that trauma of our land being stolen, our water became a commodity, bought and sold. And to this day, I mean, you can even buy paper water. Paper water means water that's not even there yet. It depends on the rain, it depends on the snow, but you can buy that paper water. And big companies moving in are doing that. Our seeds have been contaminated. So with all of that, there was a very important thing. And then what I kept seeing as we were building these institutional investments, we did a pilot back in 2018 to start the senior nutrition program. Again, that was a very small pilot, only $50,000. But those $50,000, here we were at that time, a cooperative of over 40 farms, and we made $2,500 in sales. So I was like, I already knew where those contracts were going. And they were going through the three privileged farms. And I must say three privileged white farms who already had a monopoly on everything, on the retail, on the co-op, on, you know, the major markets that we all share and grow with. So when I asked for the data, sure enough, numbers don't lie. There they were. So at that point, that's when I said, no, we really need to understand historical bias here if we're all going to grow together. And here we were, a small cooperative way back in the day in 2010, doing all of this policy work to align institutional investment. And people of color farmers were the ones taking the time to drive back and forth up to Santa Fe during the sessions, be giving the committee hearings, sharing our data. And at the end of it all, we end up with 2% of the state funding. So that's when I had to really ask for that racial equity training, which we did and we had. It was very uncomfortable. But at the same time, I think everyone stood strong in order to really move forward. We're not there yet. There's still a lot of work to do within that racial equity piece. But at least now we went through the first difficult, if you want to call it, icebreaker. During this time, too, as we're making shifts within the policy, Food and Ag policy, we brought a lot of people back to the table. The Acequia Association, which is our community governance of water, First Nations Food Institute was back at the table, really recognizing generations and generations of traditional Native farmers. We brought back so many people that were left out without that voice. And I was just recently voted in for another term, another 2-year term, as the chair of the New Mexico Food and Agricultural Policy Council. I myself struggled with that because it takes so much time, and I am running an organization, takes so much time to do that work, but it is very important work, and we need to really stick to our mission, the vision of New Mexico becoming a sustainable food state, but also recognizing all of those voices and all of the generation of trauma of all of those pieces I spoke about a minute ago. And we're still here, and we're still farming, and we're still preserving seed, and we're still taking care of the earth and our communities. I'm going to go through because I know we're running out of time. But this is some of the mission and goals of the New Mexico Food and Agricultural Policy Council. And what I do want to say is that this year in the January session, we had a historical act on food, farm, hunger, and agriculture. A $27 million act was passed. And it includes all the soil health. It includes so many pieces of all of that value food chain. And then along with that, the governor also provided additional funding of $10 million for food security, which was focused on infrastructure, food hubs, all of that. Because what I've learned throughout all this time is that there has to be a well-balanced piece between farmer capacity, investment at the state level, and also the food, farm to food system, infrastructure, and distribution. One can't grow more than the other. As we're asking for more funding in state institutional investment, are our farmers building that capacity? Do they have that capacity to continue to produce at that level? Do we have the water resources to do that? And most importantly, do we have the facilities and the infrastructure, not only in facility, but in job force creation and skills development in order to do that? So as a cooperative, we're constantly balancing all of those out. One can't grow more than the other. We all have to grow together. And that is another important reason that we've invested, you know, these past 12 years in policy work. Policy work is not easy. It brings up two emotions in me most of the time. It either makes me really angry or I want to go sit in the dark and cry. So it's not an easy place to be, but I understand the necessity to be engaged at that level. Along with it, we also have to work with our communities. And we also have nutrition education classes, community oriented, with recipes that are culturally relevant. They're bilingual, trilingual classes. And it's all still set in a community setting. We partner with our local clinic and have developed and work with a plant-based diet. We're moving into value added. So we're producing our own, this too, it helps us with food waste. It helps us really make another economy for the cooperative and network farms. And this is another piece that we're moving into for retail. And here we have a statement from our state senator, Linda Lopez. She says, small farmers are the backbone of our local economy. And because of health in our community, COVID-19 has proven that our local economy needs the financial support to help our small farmers, and our residents need access to quality, healthy food. And we all run this under Local Food Solutions, and all of our products come under the umbrella of low to no sodium and diabetic friendly. We're very excited about these products. We already are moving them, have been moving them for the past 2 years. Right here, we're getting ready to launch our baby food line, Better Ingredient Baby Food. So we're really excited about what we've been able to do collectively as a cooperative. And this again, when I showed that photo where we were making that shift, where farmers were no longer gonna grow several varieties, but we're committing to growing one crop this is what we have. Farmers that are just growing chili now. We have farmers that are just growing tomatoes now. We have farmers that are just growing sweet potato, you know, beets. And we did that because we knew this was our ultimate goal, to get to this part. And we needed farmers that could produce year round. So we started building the infrastructure for them, making sure that their hoop houses were had a geothermal that they could go year round, that we were able to help other farmers with greenhouses to grow year round and start building that infrastructure and that capacity for future growth in our food system. These are our weekly CSA bags that go out. And we have two sites on Wednesdays and Thursdays, one here at this facility and another one that we partner with the United Methodist Church. As you can see, here are the bags. There it's La Cosecha, Community Supported Agriculture. This right here shows how the farms bring it in. We store it in our walk-in coolers. There's a constant rotation going on in there because, like I said, this year we were moving 7,500 pounds weekly. And our last month in October, we were moving 10,000 pounds. So everything has to be always in a rotation. And farmers come in, we take over their documentation, and nothing has ever happened in all these years, but if it does, we can stop production within a couple of hours because we maintain a tight tracking system with all of our farmers. We know what farm, what field, what hoop house, what time, all of those pieces. This is our greenhouses that we have, and we also use on the off time, we use them as to dehydrate. There is an aquaponics piece to it. And this is too within walking distance from First Choice Community Health Clinic, where we partner within our nutrition classes. And there's two, there's an elementary school and a junior high school who named this site. They named it Raíces Sagradas, which means sacred roots. That gives them ownership. It gives their families that live around this, the clinic and the greenhouses, it gives them ownership to a new way of looking at active living and healthy eating. These right here, there's two hoop houses on this property next to each other. These grow specifically for Albuquerque Public Schools. And this is where we are now. We are in a capital campaign. We've outgrown our space here at the South Valley Economic Development Center. And we want to build a new building that will be solar powered and part of the South Valley Wellness Eco Center. We have our shovel ready project in order to get this facility going on this site. And as you see right here, here are the solar panels that's gonna power all of this building. This is the greenhouse that was shown. These are the two hoop houses that are growing specifically for Albuquerque Public Schools. Next to this is what we have. It's called McEwen Pond, but it is our safe place to recreation. We've taken out all of the invasive trees and are only let the native trees grow, and we are also doing edible gardens there. This came out of the CEO of First Choice asking a very important question after 20 years of the clinic being in our neighborhood. Is our community getting healthier? The answer, the data showed no. Diabetes was on the rise with adults and children. There were many, many diet-related diseases. And he went to the board, which is a community board, and said, we need to sponsor a six-month survey and focus groups and find out what is going to make our community healthier. Well, the answers in those surveys and focus groups wasn't, oh, yes, I go to the doctor. Yes, I'm taking my medication. It was, we need safe places to recreation. We need adequate daycare. We need pathways to living wage jobs. We need adequate housing. And at the core of it, we need access and help in better diet and access to healthy food. So that put food at the core of addressing the social determinants of health. And that is the mindset. That's why we have the nutrition classes. What I'm trying to really put out here is that a cooperative, a farming cooperative, in all of its ripple effects, has so much work that it taps into, and so many community benefits that it offers, not only in economic, but most importantly in our community's health. And the main piece is that we have to really work together collectively, because our ultimate goal here is to make New Mexico a sustainable food state. And I think COVID really showed our cooperative, because it hasn't been easy. We didn't have a model to follow. We're people of color. We don't get the same type of support and access. Now that we have a strong voice and we have really proven ourselves, now we get a little bit more attention, because we are leaders here in the state of New Mexico. We're the largest cooperative in the whole state of New Mexico. We were the first to obtain GAP certification, and we are moving and helping so many of our established farmers, but also bringing in the next generation of what is now called sustainable and regenerative farmers. So I think my time is up. I would just end with this photo. Deb Hallen was our representative here before she moved into the, as Congresswoman. And now, as we know, you know, this was the day of her election. And we were going to vote, me and my husband. And I had met her on a plane early, early on, before anybody knew Deb Hallen. We had already been following her policy on renewable energy. We were supporting her. And I met her on a plane, on a red-eye plane, coming back to Albuquerque from Houston. And I went up and introduced myself, and I said, you have a lot of support in the South Valley. And we started talking about all of her policy work. We had one of the best conversations I've ever had with anyone on the way back to Albuquerque. So we're there getting ready to vote. We went to have a bite to eat. We see a big old paparazzi. My husband says, it's Deb Hallen. And sure enough, she was getting, that was the day she became the first, well, one of the two Native congresswomen to ever be elected. We continue to have a friendship, and she continues to support us. And I put that out there because it takes people like her, it takes people like Linda Lopez, it takes all of those champions that we have within those very important places of power that understand our mission, understand our struggles. So with that, with all my heart, in my own language, Inclaneshka in Tonatiu, Tlatsukamati in Teo. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I know that we are women in places of power, Denise said. I know that we are at time, but I hope that we can relay some of these questions that came up in the chat to you. And thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you for being such a leader in this space and for our planet, for our community. I can't thank you enough, Helga. And thank you all. And if you have any questions, please, there'll be offline boards that we can, you know, collect questions, and then I can submit them over to Helga too as well. So thank you so much. And I hope you have a great rest of your day.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Okay, how do I get it?